All right, well, here we are with Fathers of the Grind, episode 61. We are going to talk a little bit about a few other games we're playing, but most of the time is going to be spent on Horizon Zero Dawn. Yeah. All right, let's go.
Who is your daddy?
I am the father.
You fathers will understand.
My father taught me many things.
I got an idea. How about you all sit there quietly while I make dad noises?
Oh, also, you'll be happy to know, I have my feminine water bottle today. It's got that lady shape that you liked so much when I first used it.
Seriously. Seriously. Oh, wow. Wow, my wife just texted me. In all caps. Oh my god, OMG. You're missing an effing amazing game. My wife is cussing now. That's amazing.
Wow. On Sunday, too.
That's... I know.
Yeah.
My son, just so you know, I mean, I won't chat about it too long because I know we're on limited time, but my son's in the championship game. This entire weekend has been nothing but soccer tournaments. All three of my kids had tournaments. And so Ian, the middle child, is in a championship game right now. So that's why she's texting me that and cussing.
Gotcha.
So gotcha. I will definitely reprimand her. I mean, I don't know who she thinks she is. Daniel Freitas or what? You know, dropping F-bombs every 5 seconds.
No, dude, your wife posted a hilarious picture on Facebook of Emily just laying into another girl playing soccer. Mm-hmm. That was awesome.
Emily loves.
I mean, to you, that's probably pretty standard.
Loves to use her shoulder. It's like her favorite thing.
I could
even
see
if
that.
It's not necessary, like there was, she'll still do
there
it.
Was no getting around it. Like, that picture told the whole story. She wasn't going for the ball. She wasn't trying any kind of finesse defense move. She was just like, my shoulder into your side. Bulldoze. Here we go. Yeah.
She loves it. Good.
So here we are, episode 61. Derek Teague is with me. My name is Tim Nestor. And as you've already heard, it's been a busy weekend, not only because of gaming, but also because of family soccer stuff. Mm-hmm. And for me, at least, we, you know, spent the evening with some friends last night. It was great. They got a bunch of boys that are the same age as our boys. That was fun. They've also adopted from Ethiopia, so that was fun. But there's also been a lot of video games. And so we're going to talk mostly about Horizon today. Here in a few minutes, Derek, I'm going to have each of us 2 minutes. And I'm going to set a timer on my phone. We're going to have 2 minutes to give our very quick Switch impressions.
Okay.
Like, whatever you want to say, because we just got it this weekend. But next week is really going to be all Nintendo Switch, all Zelda. This week, I want the focus to be on Horizon. So if you're listening and you're excited about Switch stuff and nothing else, we'll talk a little bit about it, but then shift gears into Horizon. And then next week, it'll be all Switch. If you're not real excited about Switch, don't worry. Lots of Horizon talk coming this week, all right? So, but before we get to that, Derek, what is the final count on your 4 in February?
Well, before I do that, are you telling our Nintendo listeners that they should switch to next week?
No, I'm saying they should listen through our 2 minute timer and then they can switch.
It was
switch.
A switch joke. They should switch to next week's episode.
I heard it. I was trying to save you by moving right on past it, but you didn't let me.
Let's not move on past it. That was a great switch joke.
It was good.
All right, let's
really
just
good.
Switch things up real quick and we'll go in 4 in February.
Well, you at least have to snap your fingers when you do it. Like, do the full. There you go.
Well, you know me. Like, you say start the show 5 seconds later. I start the show. All right, so nothing big here on the 4 in February. I did those 3 games that I talked about, Fuse, Killzone, and FIFA 17, and did no more. I dropped out. I did finish Halo 4 with Eli, which I counted as my 4 in February. It's breaking the rules. Don't care. It was the first game I beat with my son. And we actually did start Halo 5. We finished the first 2 levels in Halo 5. And I plan to continue to play it with him. It's great quality time with Eli. It's a hobby he and I both enjoy. Emily, I'm going to talk about her in about 2 seconds. She likes video games, but I've talked about in the past. She's not a big fan, and neither is Ian. But Eli enjoys video games, so I'm definitely going to try to put a lot of quality time, even with all these big releases. It's a Switch, Zelda, Horizon. I still have Neo, which I am not going to forget about that game. That game's way too good to just act like it doesn't exist. It's an amazing game. But I'm still going to set aside time. I'm going to try every night of the week before he goes to bed to just maybe crank out 1 level in Halo 5. So
nice. Cool.
But that's my final.
And you know
report.
What? The cool thing is, and I'm actually not being facetious at all. It's actually cool because you're getting quality time with the kiddos. So you get to play a fun game, and you get quality time with the kiddos. So that's cool.
And Halo 5 is so much fun. I love Halo 4, but Halo 5 is so much faster. It obviously is prettier because it's an Xbox One game, whereas Halo 4 was moved over to the One, and it looks good, but not at the level Halo 5 is. But
it's
Halo
one of the better-looking
so
last-gen games, for sure, but it doesn't hold a candle to Halo 5.
Sure. But Halo 5 looks good, plays so great. I really feel like I'm playing Doom, especially playing on easy and just running through the levels with Eli, and Eli's like shooting one guy while I'm killing 12.
Yeah, you're just hitting with the butt of your gun nonstop, right? Just
nonstop doing the rush move. There's like a rush move where I think you hit RB and he rushes towards him and then does a quick like melee move, and it feels like Doom.
So Eli's loving it, huh?
Oh yeah, he loves killing that one guy and being like, "Dad, where are you? Where are you, Dad?" I'm like, "All right, kill everybody in this part of the section. I'm going to the next area, buddy."
Now, are these the first games that he's, you know, used dual analog sticks to control, like first-person style, or is he already kind of adept at that?
Not really. That's why I wanted to play this with him, and that's why I'm playing it on easy, is it's an adjustment for him to be able to do, because, like, when you play, like, FIFA, which is, like, one of his main games, you really only need one stick. The right stick is used for special moves, and he doesn't really know those, so he never uses it. The other games that he plays is like Lego games, and I'm sure you use the right stick for like the camera, but it's not like playing a first-person shooter where you actually have to aim and fire and things like that. So it's definitely an adjustment for him. I mean, he understands what he has to do. It's just getting muscle memory and all that type of stuff.
Yeah, that's an adjustment. I remember when I first did dual analog sticks. Like, gosh, I guess that was probably on the PS2, I'm guessing, when I first did a first-person shooter that way. Because I had come off of some PC games and then off of GoldenEye, which used the awkward C-stick set up with the N64 controller. So that was an adjustment. But kids pick up on that stuff faster than we do. I know that.
Yeah, he's doing fine. Yeah, he's pretty good. In fact, I'll talk about it right now. He played a little bit of Zelda. And I was shocked at how well he was understanding things. So he's definitely improving as a gamer.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, I handed the controller for Horizon off to my now 6-year-old named Shepard, and he controlled it surprisingly well while keeping the camera where he kind of wanted it. He wasn't perfect, but I was already like, all right, this is silly that you're 6 and you're already controlling this better than I am. But so kids pick up on that stuff quick. All right, so that's good. That's not too bad for a 4 in February. I mean, I think Halo 4 counts simply because it was a new experience playing father and son style. So let's call it that. Mine's kind of similar in that I've definitely got 3 games finished. Gears of War Judgment, Gears of War 4, Fire Emblem Fates Conquest. I am currently in Chapter 25 of Birthright, but I, of course, haven't played it at all this weekend because I'm completely just swamped with Horizon and a bunch of Switch stuff, which we'll talk about. But I do plan on finishing Birthright. It's not totally sidelined, but I didn't finish it in February, so I can't really call that. So the closest thing I have to it is Fire Emblem Heroes, which I finished normal. I did normal, hard, and lunatic. So I have one team of, like, they're all almost level 40. So I overdid it for a mobile game, for sure. But they're all leveled up high enough. I feel very accomplished in that game. So some of you would say, yeah, that counts. That gets pretty challenging. And some of you would say, dude, get DFC out of here. With this
I love that game. That's easily my favorite mobile game. I didn't play it as much as you because I beat it on normal. I didn't even try harder or anything like that. I do still check in every day to get my orbs, and I do plan on playing the story again through on hard.
Yeah.
I got some, because I had over like 20 something orbs, I went and got new characters and unlocked 5 new characters, and I did get like 3 level 4 characters.
Nice.
So I plan on using them again. So I'll have to do training and stuff. But yeah, that game, to me, it's DFC compared to what a normal Fire Emblem game is, but it's not DFC. It's good
because it's fantastic.
Derek likes it. Derek, stamp of approval on Fire Emblem Heroes.
And dude, if anyone knows you at all, they know that's a lot when it comes to a mobile game. For you to give any kind of stamp
mobile,
of anything close to approval.
Indies are trash, in case people were forgetting, because I haven't said it in a while. Indies. All indies are trash. Nintendo, you're stupid for releasing indies on your new Switch. It's dumb.
Oh man, people those like Nindies look Tim great. You shut your mouth. Those look awesome. Those look awesome. But yeah, so by the way, quick tip for those of you playing Fire Emblem Heroes, still, if you do that draw and you get a bunch of threes, I think if you do the summon, you can't get anything less than a three.
Mm-hmm.
You can pretty easily move them up to a four.
I got a two. I got several
twos.
Oh,
on a draw? Okay. Yeah. All right. Maybe you can get twos. Yeah. But if you get a... So leveling them up from one to two costs next to nothing.
Yeah.
Leveling up from two to three isn't too much either. And so if you just go under advanced growth and unlock potential, you don't have to use too many feathers or shards for that. You can go from three to four. It'll cost you, but just playing the game regularly and doing some training, you should have enough to at least pick... Let's say you pick like two or three... three-star characters that you really want to see as level fours, you should be able to bump them up pretty quickly. There's no way that I'll be able to collect enough feathers to go from a four to a five. That costs like 20,000 feathers, which
ridiculous.
Is crazy. But you can go from three to four. I mean, I think I upgraded like five or six of them from a three to a four. Now they're great. They're really strong. So for those of you who are trying to power up your team and you're looking for ways to do it, you don't have to get just a real lucky draw from the summons. You can actually do it yourself using those feathers and those shards that you get from training. So anyway, there you go. Quick tip on Fire Emblem Heroes. And there's our summary for 4 in February. I think the consensus between the two of us at least was it was a fun challenge to do and it kept the conversation going. But people in our community just killed us when it comes to actually completing 4 in February. People in the community did a lot better than we did. So
yeah, there just
cool.
was too many great games. Like I said, Neo, I tried to ignore it for the first week Neo was out. I ignored it the first 3 days. I didn't even play it. I mean, I played like the Derek Executioner part, and that was it. And then once I started playing it, I was like, I don't care about 4 in February. Like, I was like, this is what I want to play. This is what I'm addicted to, and I love it. Neo's amazing.
All right, so here's what we're going to do. Nintendo Switch just came out on Friday, and we're recording this on a Sunday afternoon, so I got mine that midnight on Thursday night. I barely played it. But I did turn it on, and I wanted to set things up, and I turned Zelda on, but I was literally falling asleep, like almost standing up. I was so tired. So I didn't really play a lot until Friday, just a tiny bit in the morning, and then I had to work. And then so I played a ton, though, Friday evening. I pretty much put Horizon totally to the side for that whole Friday night. But then yesterday, it was Saturday, I kept playing Zelda on and off a little bit, but I really jumped back into Horizon because I knew we were going to talk about it.
Yeah.
And I really love that game. So that's kind of what my weekend's been like. And I know for you as well, at the very least, you've fired up the Switch. You've played it a little bit. Your kids have played it a little bit. So I'm going to set a timer here.
Okay.
And we're going to each have 2 minutes to give just very brief overall thoughts, whether you want to say haven't learned enough or what maybe what other games that you've tried on the Switch. So anything you want to say about the Switch in 2 minutes.
Well, before I
let
start,
you go first. Yeah.
I want you to check out, I don't know if you can see it. It's not going to come through because it's too bright. But Link is wearing a Switch shirt.
Did you get the DLC?
I did buy the expansion. But I haven't... You can go ahead and start my 2 minutes. Let me go ahead and...
Okay, here we go. So Derek's 2 minutes on the Switch. You'll hear a lot more next week, but for right now, here's Derek Teague's 2 minutes on the Switch. Go.
Okay, so I took Friday off work, and I did not go to the midnight launch. I was too exhausted from the previous night, but since I only have 2 minutes, I'm not going to go into that. Anyway, so I picked up the Switch. I have not played it much. I purchased Zelda. I purchased Fast RMX. I've played a little bit of Fast RMX, but I already knew what that was because I owned it on the Wii U. It's an awesome game. It's very difficult for a racer. It's very challenging. I even was trying to explain it to my daughter. I'm like, you've got to switch between turbo and turbo and blah, blah, blah. But so far, the Switch has really impressed me. I brought it to church today, and it like one of the youth kids I have in my youth group was like telling his parents like, that's a Switch. That's amazing. Look at it. And like basically selling it to him, explaining how much it costs, what everything does. I'm really impressed with the tech. I absolutely love the fact that I can play this handheld and take it on the go, which this weekend I've had soccer tournaments all weekend, Saturday and Sunday. And so we took it on the go. My daughter, and this is what I was going to talk about, has actually played Zelda about 3 times more than me. I've put in maybe an hour because I've been focused on Horizon, which I'll talk about in a little bit, and she's played at least 3 to 4 hours. Eli's played a little bit. She's really into it. Like I tried to show you guys, she unlocked one of the treasure chests that I bought with the expansion and got the Switch shirt. She's been collecting a lot of weapons. She even says she's gone into a dungeon. So she's been really exploring, really into it. So bottom line, I think I'm going to keep my second Switch because she's begging me to keep it. She really, really likes it. And my only reason I didn't want to do that is I was scared I would be stuck with two and nobody would play it. And I even told Emily, I said, Emily, I swear if I say I'm going to keep this and you ignore it, I'm going to be mad. But right now, I'm two thumbs up for the Switch. I think it's great. I can't talk a lot about Zelda because, to be honest, I've purposely not put a lot of time in it because the little bit I've played, I'm 100% impressed.
I mean, we gave you about 2 minutes and 2 minutes and 20 seconds there, but that's okay. We won't hate you for it.
It felt like a long 2 minutes.
Yeah, that was good, though. That was a good summary, especially considering how busy your weekends have been. I know we were texting a little bit yesterday. You guys have been going kind of nonstop all weekend, so I had a feeling you didn't have a lot of Switch time.
No.
Or video game time in general, maybe. So it's been one of those weekends. All right, here goes my 2 minutes, and go. All right, so I picked up mine on midnight at our local Best Buy. There was a good crowd there. They were giving out tickets for those who didn't have it pre-ordered. And also, in this day and age, who goes to a launch without a pre-order in hand? Like, I don't know. I don't understand that. But anyway, people still do that. They'll line up and just hope to buy one.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a lot of people there, though, and people very excited, lots of chatter about the games. I picked up Zelda. Pro controllers were all gone. Now I wish I had one because every store I've checked in the last couple of days has been out. So as soon as they get more shipments of Pro Controller, I'm going
to
get it.
I did get an email saying Amazon had it. Just wanted to say that.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Maybe I'll get it from Amazon. Because playing with the Joy-Cons on the grip works fine, but I'd much prefer to leave the Joy-Cons on the system almost constantly. And when I plug it into the system, just have the Pro Controller on the couch.
Bingo.
So that's what I want.
That's why I bought the Pro Controller.
Yeah, that's what I want to do because removing them from the side of the system is pretty smooth. It kind of feels cool, and then there's your controller ready to go. But it also is a little bit of a hassle in terms of just it's one extra step to be able to shift over to the couch.
It's
so not a big deal, but I do like it. I let my kids play a little bit. They've all dinked around in Zelda a little bit. I've probably put in 3 or 4 hours into Zelda that Friday evening, a little bit Saturday morning. Love that game. I've completed, I think, 5 shrines at this point. I haven't gotten to a real dungeon yet, but I've completed a bunch of shrines, collected a whole bunch of weapons, explored a lot. Love that game. I'll talk more about that next week. But I jumped back to Horizon Zero Dawn because Zelda was pulling me in. Like, the hooks were in me strong, and I had to choose consciously to step away from it.
Yeah.
And today I'm going to buy Snipper Clips. We're going to try that one out. But I have played Fast RMX quite a bit with the kids. Very Wipeout meets F-Zero arcade racing fun. It's really great. It's smooth. I gave each of the kids, we did it. Only have two right now, so they each had a Joy-Con. We played multiplayer, and it's a lot of fun just doing some split screen. So I look forward to doing online with some of you as well. So I love the Switch. I'm a major evangelist of the Switch, and I'll be trying to convince everyone I know to give it a shot. So there's my 2 minutes.
I do. I think the Switch, and again, we'll move on. I do think the Switch is easily better than the Wii U. So if you hated the Wii U and you hated Nintendo for that, let it go. This is way better.
Yeah, no, I'm a huge fan. I can't think of a time that I got a system that I was this impressed with how smooth everything is. The whole experience, we'll talk about it next week, but the whole experience is very smooth, and I just want games for it. Now I just want to see game after game coming out for it. So we'll talk about more of that next week. All right, but let's shift gears here, and let's talk about the other major video game release from this past week.
I'm excited to talk about this game, just so you guys know.
So am I. I can't wait. I am loving Horizon Zero Dawn. If you keep track of reviews at all, you know that Horizon Zero Dawn absolutely killed it in critically and commercially. I haven't heard official sales numbers, but it's selling like crazy. It's being reviewed insanely high. People love it, and for good reason. So I picked up Horizon Zero Dawn digitally, and I downloaded it and played it a little bit that first night, and I've played it most evenings except for Friday since then. And I absolutely love it. So what you and I are going to do is we're going to kind of just run through some general aspects of the game, kind of what you would expect. You know, we'll talk about visuals. We'll talk about the open world scope and enemy variety. We'll talk about the actual gameplay. And intermittently, we've got a bunch of community input as well. I asked the community to chime in with their thoughts, and a lot of people responded. So we'll pick a few of those to share with you guys. So before we get into kind of fawning over Horizon Zero Dawn, just wanted to let you guys know we have a contest going right now. We just started it today. Special thanks and shout out to Moose Kluwe for not only the idea for this contest, he contacted me yesterday, but also for providing the prize, which is a $20 PSN code, which is only usable in the U.S., or at least on U.S. accounts. So if you're overseas or in Canada, you'd have to make a U.S. account to figure out how to use that. But all you have to do to enter is go to the pinned post that's up there right now, or you could just search for the post on Horizon Screenshot Contest, and all you have to do is comment with the picture that you pick in the comment section of that post, and then they'll just go based off of likes. Whoever gets the most likes basically is the winner. And we have until Saturday, March 11th, to do that. So if any of you haven't done this yet, go into the Horizon pause screen, go into photo mode, and not only can you take a snapshot of wherever you're standing, whatever you're doing right then, but also you have filters and all sorts of editing options in there. So you can use whatever in-game filters you want, nothing external, and submit your photo that way. So there you go. Screenshot contest going on right now. Okay.
No.
Speaking of screenshots, Derek, I know you're not going to do that contest, but talk to me a little bit about the visuals of Horizon Zero Dawn. Let's jump right into how this game looks. What were your impressions at first, and how has it held up over your time with the game?
All right, so a couple things. Both Tim and I have 4K TVs. I have the PS4 Pro. You're still running on standard. There is an option on PS4 Pro to play this game with higher resolution, or just like Neo, or higher frame rate. I went with resolution because I'm playing on the Pro and 4K, and so I wanted to experience what this game was at its highest level when it came to visuals. And I've already said this before, I'm a graphics whore, so I love looking at beautiful games. And this game, I mean, easily the best looking open world game. There is no competition. The Witcher 3 looked great when it got its update on the DLC, but I still think this game looks better. The only game I can think of that could compete with it, though, and this is not an open world game, would be like an Uncharted 4.
Right.
I still could see how this game... I'll put it this way. The world, when you're playing the game, I think Horizon's better. Like, the way it looks, everything like that. When you're talking to somebody or anything like that, clearly Uncharted does that way better.
I even think games like The Witcher 3 and Tomb Raider do that better. But
yes, they do. Horizon, when you're talking to somebody, and some of the voice acting is absolutely hideous, it feels like Fallout 4. And even like the animations of like the characters, like they're real stiff. They talk like this.
Right.
There's no movement in the face, nothing like this. It's all... So that would be my only negative to the visuals and probably to the game, but I'll get to that in a little bit. But overall, easily for an open world game, so I'm talking Dragon Age, Inquisitions, The Witcher, all those, I think this is the best looking game.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're talking mainly when it's the over-the-shoulder view, you're exploring, you're battling, you're sneaking around. You're not necessarily talking about the close-ups on their faces, right? I mean, just to be clear.
No. Even Aloy looks good, but I would not say she's top tier when it comes to making your main character look better. I think Geralt looks better. I think Uncharted does that better. I think there's several games that do that better. But everything else... amazing. Absolutely amazing. It's gorgeous.
Okay. All right. Well, before I share my thoughts, we're going to let our buddy Manuel Sandoval, who shared his thoughts via audio, jump in here and give us a breakdown of his impressions of the game. So here's Manuel.
Hey, Tim and Derek. This is Manuel from the group. Hey, all you grinders. I'm here to talk about Horizon Zero Dawn. The game is fun. I'm really enjoying my playthrough of it. I am running a launch PS4, and even on that, the graphics are phenomenal. The plant life, the wildlife, the character models, and the robots/dinosaurs, whatever you want to call them, it all looks absolutely great. I can't imagine what you guys with PS4 Pros and 4K TVs are viewing. Sound-wise, it's just as great as the graphics. You can hear the wildlife around you. You can hear the wind rustling, the trees, much like The Witcher 3. And the voice acting is great. There is a little couple of hiccups here and there, but overall, it's a great package. The music is a great addition to this game. It almost reminds me of Skyrim, the way it affects how you're playing, pumps you up, gets you ready for the next fight or the next adventure. Story-wise, I am probably 22-ish hours into the game of playtime. I'm maybe level 26 or 27. I haven't gotten far into the game. I have gotten out of the starting area, but I haven't gotten to Meridian yet. I'm close to it, but the game just forces me, not forces me, but I want to go out and adventure everywhere, look for every, under every rock, look in every nook and cranny, trying to find out where everything is hidden. So that's why I haven't been too far into the story. Whether you are running around the world or sliding around the world, the game is just a blast to play, and I highly recommend it for any and all of you who have a PS4 who haven't tried it yet. It is one of the highlights for the PS4 of the year, and yeah, thank you.
All right, thanks, Manuel. That's awesome. I appreciate that. Derek, I agree with you completely. When I fired this game up, that whole opening sequence where there's a character who's kind of traveling and he's carrying a baby with him, that whole opening sequence, all these different shots it shows as he's, you're kind of learning a little bit about the world and the tribal setup of things a little bit, not everything, but a little bit. I was just sitting there stunned at the lighting effects and the way the shadows were falling and the way his footsteps were in the snow. And I was just like, this is already amazing. That was my initial impression. And then of course, when you, you know, I don't want to give too much away, but that opening experience is just great. When they first give you control in the game and you have to do a couple tutorial style missions, but they're also kind of setting up who the your main character is. I was blown away. I just couldn't believe how good it looked. Yeah. And yeah, I do think that some of the facial stuff actually looked pretty good. There were certain times I zoomed in and someone would talk and there was an expression that I thought, this is pretty good. But then
first two characters you meet, so that would be Aloy and then a certain somebody, I'm not going to say his name, are well acted, and even their facial animations are done a little bit better than everybody else you're going to meet.
There was more care put into them for sure than the other characters. Yeah. I totally agree with that. It wasn't until I started getting some of the side optional conversations where I started to really notice, like, okay, they maybe had to do a rush job on this one because it's not as good, not as clean, not as polished in some cases. So... but overall, it's beautiful. The actual scope of the game when you're up high and you can kind of see for a long distance was stunning. Obviously, like you said, I'm playing on a 4K TV with HDR mode on on a standard PS4, and it looks beautiful. Like, I agree with you, and I am the biggest Witcher 3 apologist that you'll meet. I agree with you that this game looks better than even Witcher 3 does. Even when Witcher 3 has the, excuse me, the weather and lighting effects come in, you know, when a storm rolls in or when the sun is setting or you're kind of just riding your horse slowly and looking to the side at the city. Witcher 3 is beautiful, and Blood and Wine improved on what the base game had by a mile, and Horizon outdoes both of them. Yeah. Horizon, just in terms of the environments and what it looks like traveling the world, it's better than both of them. I think in a lot of ways, I like the way it looks better than Uncharted 4, but that's because it is open world. Uncharted 4 is very tailored to a linear experience, and it's good. I mean, that's the way it should be. That's the way Uncharted games are. So I'm with you on that. But stepping away from comparing it to other games for just a second, it's just a fun game to look at. Everything looks great. The robots look amazing. The different armor you can have looks really cool. Looks very. I mean, sometimes the headpieces look dumb, but other than that, the armor sets look really neat. The lighting as the day and night stuff cycles through looks great. It's very cool, man. It just looks fantastic.
It really is.
So, our friend, and I hope I'm pronouncing this right. I asked him how to pronounce his name. Let me see if he responded here. Is that? Okay, got it. So our friend Ryan Croft, I would not have pronounced that correctly. Crapf. I would have pronounced it Crapf. Yeah. So Ryan Croft, thank you, Ryan, for giving me the info on how to pronounce your name. He submitted his thoughts on the game. So here's what Ryan had to say. He said, I'm 7 hours in and just worked through the proving and climbed those big giraffes, the tall necks they call them in the game. Mm-hmm. I love the concept of revealing the map that way instead of towers like in Far Cry or in Assassin's Creed. The scenery, weather, and overall environment blows Witcher 3 out of the water, in my opinion. The resource collection is just right in the sense that it's easy to get and not arduous to find the right thing to upgrade your packs. I also have a feeling that this game is going to end with, and then I edited out his prediction just in case there's a spoiler thing there.
Yeah.
He kind of takes a stab at the a twist he thinks is going to happen. And then he says it's definitely going to be interesting. And finally, the bandit huts look badass. So that was his final comment there. So thanks, Ryan. I agree with you on all counts. I do think it kind of outclasses every open world game that's come before it. And that's saying a lot because there have been some amazing ones. So I'm with you. I also like the unveiling of the map via the tall necks as opposed to just going up and syncing the map with a high viewpoint. So it's very cool. All right, let's talk about the open world. Let's talk about the scope, whether it's mission and enemy variety, or maybe for you, Derek, what motivation you have to explore. I know we've talked about open world before where maybe you get less sidetracked than I do compared to, and maybe other gamers, they're all over the place. Some people are like me and they find themselves wasting time or spending a lot of time exploring and forgetting about the main quest for a few hours. And then others lean much more towards, I just want to get through the story and see the exact main missions. I don't really care about the side stuff. So let's talk a little bit about the scope and the missions.
Yeah.
Okay. So how are you playing this game? Has this changed at all how you approach open world?
I'm playing this like how I played Final Fantasy 15, and that's, yes, I'm paying attention to the main missions, but I'm going extremely slow. I'll give you my stats real quick. I'm about 11 hours in, just under 11 hours in. I'm a level 16. I'm completing every side mission, submission, whatever you want to call it. I'm doing them all. Mainly because I find the rewards to be pretty cool. Like, one of the first side missions you run into gives you an upgraded spear. So that was huge because I like the... Even though the hand-to-hand combat is the smallest part of the combat, it's still very, very important to me. Because not only for stealth kills, but also for whenever I feel like I've come close to taking down a dinosaur, a machine dinosaur, I'll usually try to end it with a quick one or two swipes. And so having a more powerful spear was definitely a cool thing to get early on in the game. But mainly the experience points are very valuable. I find that the upgrade system is cool. Everything that I'm getting is something I'm actually using, whereas I feel like a lot of games, when they have a huge like upgrade skill tree, I'm like, yeah, I'll upgrade that because that's the one I can upgrade, but I literally never use it. I feel like
it's simple enough while having some great options there. Like, it's not overwhelming, the upgrade tree.
No,
I think
it's real basic, but I like that. I'm not a complicated person, so even like Neo, I was gonna use that example. In Neo, there's several things you can upgrade, and for somebody who's really into all that stuff, then Neo's perfect because it has everything can be upgraded. And you can create, like, combos and all that stuff. And I've gotten confused on it. I'm like, I don't know. I'll unlock this because I actually have enough to unlock it. But I'm never going to use it because I'm just not going to remember it exists.
Yeah.
I don't feel like I'm running in that with Horizon. Everything I'm unlocking, I'm like, yeah, I'll use that. Okay. It's beneficial in some way.
What about like the overall enemy variety? Because I know, so basically there are some times when you'll fight humans, but for the most part, you're taking down these robot creatures, these robot dinosaurs, essentially. What do you think about the enemy variety so far from what you've seen?
I'm actually enjoying killing both. I do enjoy hunting the mech enemies more. They're more of a challenge. That's the main reason. But I'm also enjoying, like, you know, attacking bandit huts and stuff like that when you've got, like, 30 of them and you've got to go in pretty much stealth, otherwise you get overwhelmed. But I like the fact that, I don't know, it's weird, but I just love that these dinosaurs are mechs. And I have so much fun hunting them and the way they act. They feel like they're really alive. They're constantly doing something that a real dinosaur would probably do, like eating or feeding or doing something.
So it's crazy because they're completely robotic, and yet they look and act like you would imagine dinosaurs in a movie or a video game about dinosaurs would look and act. So
exactly.
They did a great job of balancing out that, hey, these are robots, and you can take them down mechanically and with, you know, electricity, but also they're animals. So you have this weird – and it works as both. So I'm with you.
They did it. They did a great job. I enjoy it. I also like that you can scan them and you can see their weaknesses, so you can use that RPG-type element against them. So, like, for instance, I think it's the sawtooth is weak against fire. I have my normal bow. I have two bows right now, and my normal bow has the ability to use regular, like, piercing type arrows, and then there's also fire arrows. And then I have a second bow that has two different types of arrows. So it's real cool that when I first unlocked the second bow, and this was, I just recently did it, so it was around like level 15 or something. When I unlocked it, I was like, oh, I just need this new one because it's more powerful. And then when I went to use it, I was like, wait, where's my fire arrows? Where's my other arrows? And I didn't realize each bow is attached to specific arrows. So I actually had to set up my system to have both bow and arrows set up, or I should say both bows set up that I could use both of them. So against like the sawtooth, all I do is, you know, I set up some tripwires, but mainly I've gotten powerful enough that all I have to do is just aim on them and just unleash a wrath of fire arrows. Still get to me, they still attack me, and then I've got to dodge them, but they are definitely weak to fire. So I like that type of element that a lot of them, as you scan them, you'll find out what they're weak to. And then you'll also find that some of them are just not weak to anything, and you've just got to find a way to fight them the best possible way. But yeah, I love the variety in enemies, and I do not, and I want to say this, because other games, usually when you have human enemies, and then you have like some type of alien or something different, normally the human enemies are boring. I haven't found that to be the case so far. I'm enjoying fighting both. So
nice. Yeah, no, I'm with you 100%. I don't have a ton to add to that other than to say I very much agree that hunting the dinosaurs is more fun than the human, you know, fighting the human characters, the bandits. Mm-hmm. Although there is some fun to be had there too. You know me, I really enjoy the stealth, so I very quickly unlocked the whistle ability where you can, while hiding in the long grass, you can whistle and draw someone close to you and then do a quick kill. I very quickly upgraded the silent attack to be able to attack the like commanders and some of the stronger mechs as well. That way I can do quick one-hit stealth kills on them.
Yep.
But I also do find it very invigorating, very exciting when you are just in open combat and you're running and jumping and sliding and trying to knock them out and hit their weak spots. And I've died a few times, you know, just because I got excited about, hey, I unlocked this new ability to slow down time as I'm sliding. And that's cool, and it does feel really good. But, of course, some of these mechs, they'll overwhelm you and overwhelm you quickly. So it's not a cakewalk, but it's also not overly challenging. I'm playing it on normal right now.
That's how
Speaking of the difficulty, let me just have one of our community members interrupt real quick. It's Jason Marshall, and he shares his thoughts on the game, including what I would consider to be just a small little touch of Snobby Jason taking a page out of the Snobby Tim handbook at the very end when he talks about the difficulty. So here's Jason.
What's up, guys? These are my thoughts on Horizon. Bear with me. This is my first video review of sorts. Usually, if you've read any of my stuff, I'll write it down, rewrite it, probably even write it a third time before I publish it. So I guess my tagline would be Skyrim meets Torok. I think that sums it up. I mean, this might be one of the greatest open world games I've played in a long time. I can't remember being this excited to log on to a system and just it feels like for any of you World of Warcraft players, hunting the spirit beast and logging on at a certain time and then the excitement for the catch. The game is just, first off, it looks absolutely stunning. I mean, And for something to look like that, you would think the load time would just be obnoxious, but going in and out of focus, climbing, I've noticed no frame rate drops, no loading when looking in the distance. The combat's fluid. easy to learn and easy to use. I guess my only gripe with the game is how easily overpowered you can get. I'm playing on the hardest difficulty, but even then, the way I play, side quests, just roaming, killing random dinosaurs, wildlife, I notice you tend to overlevel a bit. Most quests I get are 2-3 levels below me. But it's not the worst thing in the world. The game's just so much fun. Even being over-leveled, it doesn't seem to make it like where you're one-shotting. I mean, I thought that was the case, and a sawtooth ripped my head off. Yeah, I mean, I really hope this game... obviously, all the reviews are in. Everyone loves it. So I'm hoping this is a new IP for PlayStation, and we see sequels of sorts. Not really sure where they'll go, because I haven't finished the game, so I don't know what the story lines up, but maybe this universe or something could spin more games. But if it doesn't, I think I'd be perfectly happy with this game ending, and that's it. I mean, I'm having so much fun. Well, I hope the rest of you enjoy it as much as I do.
All right, thanks, Jason. And of course, you're playing it on the hardest difficulty, you snobby snob. But anyway, no, I agree with him. That it's absolutely a blast to play. And so when I think about the scope of the open world, I love how much there is, but I also, when you look at the big map and you zoom out, it doesn't feel like they're just trying too hard to have a massive world. It looks like it's a very well planned out map from what I can tell so far. Like each area seems to make sense. There's some snowy mountainous areas. There's some, you know, really rich with greenery type valleys. It's very cool the way the whole thing's laid out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like you. I'm fairly early in the game. I haven't pushed through the story super strongly. I think I just hit level 14 last night when I was playing it. So I'm about, level 14. And I'm doing all the side mission stuff too. So I'm doing everything I can to just keep leveling up. There's a lot of satisfaction in doing that kind of stuff. Story-wise, it's interesting. I'm intrigued by the mystery of who did the big thing and why. You know, I don't mm-hmm. want to give too much away, but there's a big moment that happens early in the game, and you know, you got to figure out why. So I'm very intrigued by the story as well. But the scope of the open world, the enemy variety, so far mission variety is okay. But it's kind of what you expect. You know, hey, we need 10 boar hides. Hey, I lost my ring. Can you go find it for me? Hey, you know, so-and-so's lost. Can you go find them? And they have you use your tracking skills to do some cool things to track them down. But for the most part, you have to get to an area, clear it of enemies, and then you trigger the next cutscene, and the mission's over. So it's not incredibly creative with its mission variety, but because the game is so fun to play, it's not. I can't even knock the game for that. It's just so fun to play. So...
yeah.
In terms of like motivation to explore, I feel like just because the game is so pretty, I'm happy to go wherever the game wants me to go. And there are times when it's like, hey, I just want to get to the top of this hill to take a screenshot. They do have an awesome photo mode, like I talked about earlier. If you guys haven't tried it, give it a shot. All right, so our next community member to chime in, I'm going to butcher his last name like I did last time. So I'm just going to say Jürgen. So Jürgen chimed in with his thoughts on the game. He says... this game is phenomenal. It's the first game that makes me want to take screenshots. It's a beautiful open world so far, and he's only seen one glitch. This dude was missing his torso until he came up closer. Jürgen and I actually saw that same thing. It was after I cleared that first bandit camp, and as they were coming up to make a request of me, the guy walking up, all I could see was like his leggings and his boots and his weapon and then his head floating above it. There was just a split second there where his torso was gone. So I saw that exact moment as well. But that's the only glitch that I've seen, too. Okay, and he says he loves the combat, but when you're fighting bigger machines at the same time, it can be a bit unfair if you're ambushed or not prepared right. Just been to Meridian. It has no problem with all the people and houses around. I think he's talking about the performance, the frame rate there. The only thing I dislike so far is the facial expressions. They're really not there. They're not something huge, but they can be weird sometimes. Mm-hmm. But the story is interesting and engaging, and I get sidetracked by side missions and stuff. So, Jürgen, I'm right there with you. We just talked about the facial stuff when it comes to the visuals, so we totally agree on that count.
Let me say this before we move on to the next thing.
Yeah.
One of the things that I like about this game is it, and this has just been recent release after recent release, but it reminds me of Final Fantasy 15 as far as enjoyment. Like, the reason why Final Fantasy 15 was my game of the year was because it was just fun to play. Like, I wanted to explore the story, and I, so far, let me say this, because I haven't talked about it at all, I think Horizon has a better setup for a better story. I'm hoping it pays off, but I do think it has a better story so far than Final Fantasy 15. But Final Fantasy 15 was just fun to play, and so I would just do like monster hunting type quests over and over and over, and I would just explore areas and just kill everything. And that's kind of how I'm playing this game. Yes, I'd love to rush through it because I'd be like, well, I could go back to Neo or I could go to Zelda. But I'm like, no, I just want... To me, this is not a once-in-a-lifetime type experience. I literally can't say that because we've got two-in-a-lifetime experiences right now.
I know.
Released in the same week.
It's crazy.
But these type of releases are semi-rare.
Right.
That they're games that are just this big and beautiful and just so much fun to play. And that's how I'm playing this game. Like, I'm in no rush. Yes, I want to beat it. Yes, I want it to reveal its mysteries to me. But at the same time, I just want to take in everything. And I want to get the best weapons.
Yep.
As somebody who played Far Cry Primal and didn't like it as much as you, this game does everything that I didn't like about Far Cry Primal way better.
And that's a good comparison just in terms of the setting and some of the visuals and the lighting. I mean, and even some of the way that they set up the world. Far Cry Primal did an admirable job at trying to do a lot of that, and Horizon trumps it in every area in terms
of... In my opinion, yeah. Like, they didn't make the hunting tedious. Like, you can literally get any animal that you need in any area. Instead of, like, where in Far Cry Primal, they're like, oh, you need this rare lion or tiger. Well, you'll probably find it over here, 3,000 miles away.
Yeah.
This game, like, hey, you need 4 boar skin. Okay, I can walk anywhere and find 4 boars.
Yeah.
You know, that type of stuff. So they just do a really good job. I don't remember who said it. It might have been Ryan who said, he's like, it doesn't feel tedious. It feels like it's easier to upgrade your character, which is awesome.
Right. Yeah, because you still have to go hunting for, what am I trying to say? For the elements or for the ingredients to craft stuff. So you still have to go look for it. You still have to keep an eye out for it. But there's enough that you don't feel like you're getting frustrated. Now you got to waste your time just farming stuff.
Yeah.
So they do a good job of that too, I think. Now we've already talked a little bit about gameplay. That's the next section we're going to cover. We talked a little bit about combat and some of the RPG elements, but why don't you talk a little more about that? What do you think overall about the fighting and the combat, the way that works, and then how the upgrades play into that? Give me the overall thoughts on combat, using that bow and arrow, using the different traps maybe, or melee. What do you think about combat?
I mean, as somebody who's not big on stealth, like this, going into this game, I knew you were excited for it. In fact, I was talking to my friend at church, Nate Clark. He's in our group. He just never talks.
Hi, Nate.
But I and I don't even think he listens to our show because he doesn't care about me.
Bye, Nate.
Yeah, jerk. But I was telling him about the game because he has a friend at work that was telling him. He's like, oh, yeah, my friend told me about this game. I was like, I think you'll really like this game because when I went into it, I didn't think I would love it as much as other people. And there's two reasons why. It's built off stealth. Like, they want you to play it stealthy. They don't force it, but as anybody who's played the game has realized, Ian won his tournament. But anybody who's played
Congrats,
the game...
Ian. That's awesome. Let's take a moment and let's all give Ian a round of applause. All right. Good job, Ian.
4-2.
Good job, buddy.
But what I was going to say is the game wants you to play stealth. Again, they don't force it. You can get caught and you can get your way out of it. So I'm not a big stealth guy, so that's a negative to me. And then the second thing was one of my least favorite things in Rise of the Tomb Raider is the bow. I understand it's the most popular thing, but there's a reason why. It's just, it's too slow. It's too precise. I like machine guns. That's one of the things I didn't like about Far Cry Primal is you had to be very slow and very precise, and it was very built off stealth. Again, it wasn't forced, but it was kind of pushed towards, like, this is the best way to play it. And so going into this game, that's how I felt like the gameplay was going to be. And to a certain extent, it is. But the way they do stealth, they give you so many options in the beginning of the game. And let me explain or elaborate on that. First of all, your first bow has two types of arrows that we talked about. You have one where it's basically a sharp edge arrow that pierces an enemy with greater strength. And then you have your fire arrows that you can unlock. Then you also can unlock these traps. You get pretty early in the game this tripwire type thing. And the tripwires can either be fire, bolt, or so on. They have different ones for different types of enemies. So they make it really easy. Like, you scan an enemy. Oh, say Sawtooth is weak to fire. I'll use a fire trap. I'll use fire arrows. And one of the things I liked is, even though I am playing it stealthy, and I am crawling around, I am trying to one-shot a lot of these enemies and do the silent strikes like you were. But if I've got, let's say I kill everybody stealthy except one enemy, and I know I can take them out, I can just raise up out of the bushes and just fire 20 fire arrows at them real fast and take them down.
Which feels awesome, too. Yes. Because especially if it's fire arrows, they catch on fire and it looks so cool because they're running around and they're kind of like making all this noise because they're burning, but they're still trying to attack you. And especially those sawtooths, because those are kind of crazy fights.
Sawtooths freak out.
Yeah, the most recent fight I just did was against two sawtooths.
Yeah.
And it's the end of a mission. I'm sure you did this one, too. Yeah, I actually had trouble with that battle, but it was fun because there was no stealth involved at all. So it was all just straightforward. They jumped out and attacked me, and I was like, well, here we go. And so I'm running and sliding and jumping and healing myself a lot because they kept – and then a few times I would hide around the corner of a building and just try to find some medical herbs real quick to keep healing and then jump back out, set a few traps, and just fire arrows, like you said. Just – I mean, I probably did three
– fire them so fast, and this is
you
how
can.
I –
You can. It's almost like a gun because it goes so quickly.
That's what I was telling my friend Nate. Yeah. I was like – it's basically like you're playing with a machine gun, but it's just fire arrows. Boom, 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 boom. She's real quick with them. So, so you can play this game both. You can play it stealthy, or you can play it guns blazing. And they give you enough stuff that you can craft. You can do this. Or you can do both, which is kind of how I play my games. I do, where in the beginning I'm like, oh, I'm going to secretly come up here. You know, you saw my video of Dishonored where I like stealthed up. And then I saw a guy and I was like, okay, screw it. And I just went in guns blazing. You know, that's how I play this game. I'll take a few enemies down stealth. And then when I feel like I have the advantage, I go in guns blazing. And it's worked out so far. It hasn't been too hard. I've died a few times, but overall, I'm enjoying it.
Yeah. And of course, like we talked about earlier, they do have a lot of RPG elements in that you can upgrade your carry capacity for all sorts of different items, weapons, outfits. There's general armor outfits to get. You're not putting on, like, you know, different boots, different, you know, torso pieces, different helmets. It's just like a general outfit that you put on. But you still can upgrade your defense or upgrade your stealth or upgrade your resistance to certain things. Most of them, if they're a good piece of gear, will have some sort of modification slot. And you collect modifications throughout the game where you can bump up certain stats here or there. It took me a while to remember to use those. Once I did, all of a sudden, I noticed a difference. And so they're great. And of course, weapons, you got everything from a slingshot type thing that can launch like kind of like bombs, like freeze bombs or fire bombs or shock bombs. You've got your bow and arrow, of course. You've got, like Derek said, all these different traps. And they work really well. So you aim the traps like a bow, and it shoots in one spot, and you got to pick another spot to basically create a tripwire with this giant rope. And it works great. I mean, it's very seamless, very easy to figure out. And so the combat, I think, is a lot of fun. When I die, I realize it's my own fault. Like, oh, I didn't do that quite right. My aim was maybe bad. You know, if I could have hit that watcher right in the eye, he's dead in one shot. If I could have hit that strider on that little back piece where his weakness is. They do a good job of letting you scan them before you jump in the battle, and then it will highlight their weak points. So as you're battling, you can just aim for the bright yellow spot where their weak spot is. And they all have different ones, you know, like some of them have it on their back, some of them it's right in their eye or
I think the Sawtooth has it under its underbelly.
Yeah, so and he raises
sure
up to attack.
It has like a fire area under its underbelly or something.
Yep,
like
and if you can get him there, it's a ton of damage, and he'll raise up to attack. But, man, the combat's a lot of fun, and the RPG elements of upgrading your skills in addition to upgrading your gear is fun and yet not overwhelming. So like if you're someone who hears about Nioh or Dark Souls or even Final Fantasy and you're like, man, that's just a lot of things to track. To me, this is just the right number of things to track. You can upgrade, you can improve, but you're not going to be overwhelmed, I don't think, by the details here, by the stats here. You will run out of item space, so you'll want to either drop useless stuff or go to a merchant and sell that stuff.
That's easy to upgrade. I went from 30 slots to 70.
Yeah, really quickly.
So I don't even need to drop things anymore because I usually am carrying about 40 things, and then by the time I'm getting up into the 40s or 50s, I go find somebody, and I pro tip for anybody who gives a crap. I only sell what says only to sell. Meaning, like, if it says can trade with vendor or whatever they're called, right, or sell for metal shards, I won't sell it. And the reason why is that stuff, because
there's going to come a merchant who has an item at some point, but all he wants in return is a watcher lens or something.
He'll say, exactly. He'll say, I'll give you this rare item or exotic type item, but you have to give me 800 metal shards and 2 watcher lens or something like that. And in the beginning of the game, when I first started getting all this special stuff, anything that I couldn't craft, I was selling. And then I went to go buy a purple armor set, and I found out, I needed 2 of these items that I already sold. And when I went to the buy back option. Yeah, that's a good tip, because
there are plenty of items you'll pick up, like little trinkets from the world before, like an old watch or whatever else. And those things, it'll just say you can sell for metal, what's it called?
Shards.
Metal shards. And so those are clear to sell. You're never going to use them for anything else. But you're right. A lot of times you look for it to say used to craft, mm-hmm, and otherwise you'll get rid of it. But yeah, if it says you can trade with merchants, hang on to it.
Then hang on to it. And so it's important, if you're going to hang on to all that stuff, that you upgrade your resource packet, because you are, as you explore the world, you're going to find a lot of rare trinkets. And that will lead to you having to drop stuff you don't want to drop. So that was one of the first things I did, was upgrade my resources, because I just wanted to be able to pick up whatever I wanted, whenever I wanted, and not have to sell certain things that I didn't want to sell.
Yeah. Yep. Well, and we had, our friend Moose Cluel, who actually was also the source of our screenshot competition. So thanks again, Moose, for that. He had some thoughts as well. So here's what he said. He says, "Yo, Tim and Derek." Want to say yo back to Moose?
No.
Okay, good. He says, "Horizon is an amazing game with some flaws. I find that while the combat is awesome, I mean robot dinosaurs, some things have issues." So here he lists a few things.
Okay.
"As stated in a couple of posts to the Facebook page, the lip syncing for the character animations are a bit off and sometimes downright creepy."
Agreed.
Luckily, I rarely read their lips while watching dialogue scenes. Number 2, he says, "I know the staff or the spear and melee combat is secondary, but it lacks the customization of the rest of the gear you have." I also agree with that. "All I've done with the spear so far is completed one side mission." He says, "Let me see your spear." And all of a sudden, I'm doing a little more damage. Otherwise, I'm not seeing much there.
Yeah.
Number 3, he says, "Some of the bots are bugged, or the areas they are in are bugged. We are led to believe they will behave in a certain way, but sometimes they don't. Like when you whistle, sometimes they only come so far before turning around." I actually haven't experienced that, but Moose is saying that he did. He said they should come all the way over to you. I haven't had that problem. Every time I whistle, they come all the way to the spot where I whistled from. Number 4, he talks about kind of the lore of the game. The religion in the game lacks logic. He says, "Aloy is born in the hall or mountain of Mother, yet is cast out because she has no real mother that we know of yet." Whereas he thinks most tribal religions would have held her in high regard. That's interesting. Haven't thought about that. He says that breaks the immersion for him a little bit, just because it doesn't feel like a real tribal religion. It feels kind of pieced together. All of these are minor flaws in my opinion, though, and the combat, free roaming, and world make for a fantastic game and experience. It doesn't hurt that the game is gorgeous. I'm over 20 hours in and only level 18. This will be the game I enjoy for a long time. So thanks, Moose. Good thoughts. I agree with you on most of those points, but I'm with you. Most of those gripes are pretty minor. They don't really affect the overall experience.
I mean, I wanted better facial animation, and I was a little nervous about the voice acting, as I voiced many, many times on this show before the game launched. But I said, and I may have even said it on the show, I did say, if I can give Fallout 4 a pass, which I found a lot of enjoyment in Fallout 4, not as much as I'm enjoying Horizon, to be very clear. But I gave Fallout 4 a pass. I wanted more. I expected more. But they didn't do it. But I still found a lot of enjoyment in the game. I can do that with this game. And so far, I am definitely more intrigued by the story, and Fallout 4 had a decent story and had a decent twist, than I was with Fallout 4. I don't have the same gripes as Moose as far as, hey, this isn't realistic. I have no issues with what they've done so far with Aloy and how they've set it all up. I'm fine with it. I think it's great. I think it sets up a lot of mystery. I think there's a lot of things they have to explain, and from the reviews, it seems like they did not miss when the game ends. It seems like they kind of hit off on an acceptable ending. A very good ending is pretty much the impressions I got.
I've heard even people who are usually very critical about this kind of stuff say there's a very satisfying conclusion to the story.
That makes me happy.
Yeah. That's for me too, because a lot of times when you're making a video game, obviously story isn't always the top priority. They just want it to be fun to play. They want you to buy more DLC, whatever. But I'm glad to hear that they put a lot of thought into the story. That's pretty cool. All right, so let me ask you this. How, for you, does it stack up in 2017 so far? Also, and you don't have to rank it necessarily, but you know, just give us a ballpark of how it's stacking up. But also, for other open-world action games like Far Cry, like Assassin's Creed, like Rise of the Tomb Raider, how is it compared to other open-world action games?
I mean, at this point, and you guys should know how much I love Final Fantasy XV, I think this is the best open-world game I've ever played. And that's including The Witcher 3 and Dragon Age Inquisition. Again, the story would have to finish off being amazing, because I still feel like The Witcher 3 has better voice acting, better characters. But at this point, the combat for... I guess I should say the fun that I'm having in this game is tops right now. It's up there with Final Fantasy 15. Like, I found Final Fantasy 15 to be more fun than Dragon Age and The Witcher 3. That doesn't mean I think Final Fantasy is the better... Final Fantasy 15 is the better open world game. I think The Witcher 3 is probably your better open world game when you include everything, right? I think this game could end up competing with it. I really do.
Okay.
I like the main character. She's not annoying. Even though I'm not in love with her voice actor like other people are, because I didn't like Life is Strange as much as many people, and one of the reasons why is I didn't really care about the main character. So I don't love the voice actors, but I don't find any of them annoying. And I think they give good enough efforts, or whatever they're called. I'm blanking right now. But good enough acting that I believe in the story, and I'm hoping it pays off.
At least for the recurring characters, I think they do. So, like, for the matriarchs, I feel like whatever ladies do those voices are pretty committed. Like, I believe they're believable. Even though they're kind of crazy characters, I think there's a character named Ross who you guys meet very early in that game. I think his voice acting is
well
great.
He's probably the best character in the game so far.
Absolutely, yeah. And his acting is great. I do think I'm blanking out on her name, the girl who does Aloy's voice does a great job. I think she's on other voices and things like, I think she did some Telltale stuff. She definitely did Chloe from Life is Strange. She's done some other things.
Oh, she's not bad. I just personally love her.
I think she does a good job. And Aloy herself, the way the character's designed and the bright red hair with kind of the dreadlocks look, like, she just looks awesome. Like, she's totally believable to me as this awesome warrior. She's fantastic. So I love her as the lead. I think she's great. But yes, there are plenty of side characters where it almost feels like, hey, Joe down in coding's got a pretty good voice. Let's get him to come up and do a character. You know what I mean? Some of them feel like just someone on staff to fill in the spot. And they're not horrible.
Hey, Aloy, heard you were not supposed to be here. Oh, wow, that's really good.
You seen them robot dinos down there? Yeah, so some of them aren't great. But again, it's not... Sometimes it's a little immersion breaking, but not so much that it takes away my enjoyment of it. I'll just typically skip through some of those because I have subtitles on. I think that's the default of subtitles. I leave them on, and I'll just do a quick skim of what they're saying, and I'll skip through some of the voice acting if
it's
that
bad. Yeah, I've done that on a few conversations with side quests. Yep, where I know all they're going to do is ask me to do something. So I'm like,
just get to it. Tell me what thing I have to kill.
Yeah.
So anyway, no, I totally agree with you. To me, it stacks up as one of the best games so far of this generation. That's what my experience so far. Definitely one of the best games this year. I don't want to give away too much on how I'm thinking for Game of the Year just yet. There's a certain other game we'll talk about a lot next week that is just pace for pace with Horizon right now in my book. So we'll talk about that next week, though. To me, it's stacking up as one of the best of the year. It's stacking up as one of the best of this generation as well. And our friend Alan Heinen, who's done some design work for us as well, he's part of the group, his take is this. Dear Guerrilla Games, this is bona fide gaming perfection. Love, love, love this game. So, Alan, you summed it up. I'm with you. It's basically, I think I texted you, Derek, about this, basically saying, this is essentially all that I want from a video game. A cool world, very unique. It's got a lot of lore, a fun combat system with elements of stealth. It's beautiful to look at. Like, that's pretty much what I want from every video game, and this game nails it. So I agree with Alan. Yeah. And I wanted to share the thoughts from one of the guys from our group, Thomas James Jaredis, who constantly and continually, consistently is sharing some awesome thoughts on games he's playing. If you guys haven't recognized that yet in the group, I encourage you to go read some of his posts. As he plays through games, he updates us on what he's experiencing and what each moment is like. And I think he does a pretty good job of keeping it relatively spoiler-free as well. So, so here are Thomas's thoughts on the game so far. He says he's not finished with the game yet. Obviously, that'd be crazy. He says he's about 16 hours in. He's seen a nice chunk of the main story. Aloy is definitely a very, very likable character from the outset, and the relationship between her and a certain other main character carries some emotional weight. I edited out a little bit of what he said, a little spoilery. The visuals are beautiful to look at, easy to see from all the screenshots taken, and the frame rate, at least so far, has remained pretty steady. The controls are pretty smooth and work well. It's easy enough to go into your weapon wheel and switch it up or craft ammo if you have enough supplies. The environments are nicely varied and flow together well. It's like I was saying with the map. Without giving the feeling of a cohesive world. Nice that a fast travel option becomes available and the campfires are reasonably spaced, so if you do die, you never are set back too far at all. The robo dinos are wonderfully created, behaving in a naturalistic manner, like we talked about earlier, Derek. Mm-hmm. They too are a nicely varied bunch, and it's been a joy discovering new types as I get farther in the game. The main story is interesting and presents an intriguing mystery. Side quests have been enjoyable as well. Not quite up to Witcher 3 quality, but close. Guerrilla has done a fantastic job at world building, and the characters of Aloy in particular and the ones that she's been meeting have been well written and voiced for the most part. The game for me really does seem to be a mix of Far Cry Primal and Enslaved Odyssey to the West. Good comparison there with Enslaved. I actually agree in terms of aesthetics and kind of the setting, I agree with. With a touch of The Witcher thrown in for good measure. Aloy's focus ability reminds me of Geralt's Witcher sense. If I scored it now, I'd probably get a 9.5 out of 10. Sony has really set the bar high for exclusives early on with this and Neo, two new IPs that have made spectacular debuts. So thank you, Thomas. Love that description. I agree with everything.
I would say for me, just like if I had to like compare games, I obviously see the Far Cry Primal. That's pretty obvious. But I feel like it's got a lot of Fallout 4 to it. There's just a lot of exploration and hunting, and just the gameplay is, I'd say gameplay is king and everything else is secondary. Yeah. I'm not saying they do everything else terribly. They do certain things really well, and Thomas explains a lot of what they do very well, but I do feel like it's like a Fallout 4, Fallout type game.
Yeah.
Both of those combined.
Yep. I agree with that completely. So this is kind of a dumb question. I put it in there before we had played it. Is this game, do you think, in the early running for your game of the year?
Of course. But yeah, I will obviously. I will say this. This is going to be a very tough year because Neo really is that good to me. And that's why I keep talking about it. It's Neo to me, and I haven't beat it, is just as good as Bloodborne, if not better. And so when you're dealing with a game that I love Bloodborne, I beat it 2 times and I'm at the end of the third run. I don't know if I'll ever do it because I just was playing it a third time for fun. But so basically I beat it 3 times. But Neo to me does a lot of things that I loved about Bloodborne just as well, if not better. And then added on things that Bloodborne didn't even touch. You know, with customization and the RPG elements being way, way bigger and better in that game. So when you've got games like Neo, you've got a game like Horizon, and I have barely even touched Zelda. And by the way, that's my daughter up there who's addicted to the Switch. I'm not exaggerating. She just keeps playing Zelda. So that's
smart
what
girl.
She's doing right now. She's playing Zelda. I'm going to actually have to start my own game. So I'll probably keep my second Switch. The second one's going to be mine. She can have that one. And I'm just going to start my own game. But I haven't even touched Zelda. And I really do think, even though I'm not a Zelda fanboy, never have been, never will be, I think this Zelda game could be what I love, because I love these open world type games where you just explore and you get better loot, and then when you get stronger, more powerful and better, you then go conquer a dungeon or whatever it is. And it's just been a special first part of this year. So
it definitely has. And in a few weeks, you and I are going to do our kind of game of the year watch for Q1. So we'll get there.
Say hi,
in a few weeks here.
It's a temple.
So, yeah. All right. So let's wrap it up with one final thought from our...
She's yelling at me that I shouldn't have said dungeon. It's a temple.
Oh, it's a temple. Oh, my. All right.
Excuse
Thank you,
me.
Emily. Thank you, Emily. All right. So let's wrap up with one final community thought from our friend over at Ariana's House YouTube channel, and that's John Martin. John, let's get your unique take on this conversation.
All right. Hey there, grinding fathers. So apparently I'm supposed to talk about Horizon Zero Dawn, but I don't have it. And I don't have it because I just bought a grill that's really nice. So I'm here to talk about my very nice grill. It is a dual grill. It has a propane side for quick and easy meals, you know, on a weeknight when you just want to throw something on the grill real quick and get it done. But then it also has a side where you can use charcoal or, my preference, wood, which is also very awesome. And, you know, that's for the more low and slow weekend barbecues where you actually want to get some smoky flavor in your food. Very excited. Go check out the Fathers of the Grind page. I posted a picture of it. It's so awesome and wonderful. This had nothing to do with Horizon Zero Dawn. So, yeah, but I don't care because I got an awesome grill. See you later.
All right, John. Well, thanks for that. I love hearing about the grill. That's fantastic, but you didn't play the game at all. That doesn't help us at all. That's okay, though. You know, only thought, John, that I have for you is stop using your phone while driving. I'm just going to throw that out there. All right. That's pretty much it. Derek, thanks for talking Horizon.
Yeah.
I got to get going. I'm actually going to see Logan with some buddies this afternoon.
Brood.
So I'm going to be taking off. So, yeah, going to see Logan and then jumping back into Horizon this evening. So, all right, thanks for taking time to chat. And thank you all for listening. Be sure to share, rate, all that kind of stuff, the show. That'd be great. It always helps us to grow. And next week, it's all about that Switch.
Zelda.
That's right. All right, see you guys.
Who is your daddy?
I am the father.
You fathers will understand.
My father taught me many things.
I got an idea. How about you all sit there quietly while I make dad noises?